Good evening, everyone. Dr. Rohini here with the new topic, that is blood vessels. Today we are going to discuss the part 2 and the part 3 after some days, but part 2 is what we are going to discuss. And give me a second. We have already done with the part 1 where we talked about the histology of the blood vessels. We spoke about what are the tunics that is present in the blood vessel, the three tunics. We call them as the intima, media and adventitia. We call them tunics because they are something like tubular. That's why they're called tunics. So you have three layers, and the variation in the thickness of the layers is what makes the blood vessel either an artery or a vein. Even in artery, we have got large-sized artery and the medium-sized artery. Then we also have capillaries. Okay, there are three different varieties where the thickness of each layer, the tunica media, intima and adventitia, is what decides whether it is a medium-sized artery or a large artery. So here also there is difference. So there is difference between the artery and vein, as well as there is also difference between the medium-sized and large artery as well. So we'll see all that. And there is a lot of applied aspects that is associated with the connective tissue that is present within the wall, and also the plaque formation, thrombus formation, and the blood that flows through the channels. All this has a lot of effect on the clinical aspects that we are going to discuss. Okay. All right. Let me just make things accessible. Okay, here we have, first of all, what is the difference between the elastic artery and the muscular artery? Because in the last class itself, we have already discussed that there are three types of, tunics. We have discussed tunica, intima, media, and adventitia. Now, there is difference between elastic and muscular, that you know, and what layer is different and how different it is. Let's see. So you have this intima, which is the innermost one. That's why it's called intima, and it faces the lumen. So you know that it is much thicker. It is thicker compared to the muscular artery. So here it is less thicker. So you can call that as thinner. And then there is subendothelial connective tissue, which is less. Now, the connective tissue has less elastic fibers compared to the elastic artery, because the elastic artery is also known as large artery. Why do you call this elastic artery? Because of the more elastic fibers. So that's why the name elastic artery. And also there is internal elastic lamina. IEL is internal elastic lamina. So this is very prominent in case of muscular artery, because the lumen is small. So what happens? It gets frilled and it looks like very nice bright frill. That is internal elastic lamina. But as the lumen stretches, you can imagine when you stretch your dress, the pants or anything that has got an elastic, you can see that the elastic also will stretch and it will lose its elasticity. So it will look more stretched and it will look less distinct. So it is not distinct in case of elastic artery. And then you can see the tunica media has more of elastic fibers, and you will also see some smooth muscle fibers. Here, now, external elastic lamina. So there is this internal elastic and external elastic lamina. This marks the end of tunica media. So beginning and end of the tunica media is by elastic lamina. Both are very prominent. So in this case, the muscular layer is very prominent. That's why the name muscular artery. So which layer is very prominent and demarcated clearly? It is the muscular layer, the second layer. That's why the name muscular artery. And then you have the third layer as a hole in artery itself. This is very, very thin, very, very thin. Only in case of veins, you can see that the adventitia is thick. Here also, the thickness is more, but sometimes it could be equal to the thickness of the media itself. But tunica adventitia, compared to the vein, it is thin. Next, we'll see the difference between the vein and the artery. Like if you take up the medium-sized artery, you just heard what is prominent. I told you internal elastic lamina is prominent, external elastic lamina is prominent, and tunica media is very thick. That's why it is called medium-sized artery or muscular artery. Why? That is the reason they maintain or retain their patency. They don't lose their elasticity. So you can imagine the muscular artery, they maintain their shape throughout. And then there is this medium-sized vein. So here, one thing you should quickly observe is the collapsed lumen. So unlike the lumen, which is very patent, the lumen of the vein is collapsed. And here the wall is also very thin. And also there is no internal elastic lamina or the external elastic lamina. So elastic lamina is not present to alter the shape of the lumen. And you can see that the collagen fibers are present all over. It is not just in tunica media. It is also in tunica adventitia. And one more thing you can notice in veins is presence of valves, which is not there in case of medium-sized artery. So that is the difference between artery and the vein. Okay, let's move to the actual picture where you can identify the artery, artery wall, that is intima. Look at the beautiful internal elastic lamina, right? This is internal elastic lamina. Look at how frilled it is. And you can also see the endothelium. Endothelium is squamous cells, which is lining. And there is smooth muscle in case of the artery. Okay, not just smooth muscle fibers, but there is also elastic fibers. You can see the three layers. This is the artery. It could be large artery or medium artery, but this is the way it looks. And then there is this vein, where you can see that the internal elastic lamina is missing. This is not there in case of the vein. And you also see the thickness of the adventitia. It is more thicker. You may also see some vasa vasorum and smooth muscle fibers in the adventitia. So this is also present. Sometimes these vasa vasorum also undergoes inflammation. These vessels which are present in this layer, that is adventitia, they also undergo inflammation and they can also have so many clinical aspects. We'll talk about that. Okay, so now for now, you remember the artery lumen, vein lumen, how it looks. So you can identify a artery and a vein by now. So now there are various ways the lumen, the blood that flows in the lumen can, alter the shape, and it is because of various factors. The blood pressure is nothing but the pressure that is exerted on the walls of the arteries. Now here it is regulated by so many factors. It could be humoral factors or renal control system. Then that is angiotensin system. Now here you can see that blood pressure is not just because of the cardiac output, it is also because of the resistance that you find in the vessels. So there are so many other neural factors as well which contribute to the blood pressure. So now there is two things that can happen with the blood pressure, right? There is increase in blood pressure or decrease in blood pressure. When can there will be increase in blood pressure? Whenever I told you there is neural factors also. So neuronal factors or neural factors, you can imagine when you are under sympathetic nervous system stimulus. You know, sympathetic is fight or flight. When this is activated, this is part of the autonomic nervous system. When this one is activated, obviously your blood pressure is something that increases. And then humoral factor, that is renin, angiotensin, aldosterone system, and then vasopressin. Vasopressin, you know, it is secreted by the posterior pituitary. And then glucocorticoids, this is from the suprarenal gland. Suprarenal gland has how many layers? Anyone has any idea? What are the different layers that you can see in the suprarenal? Anybody? Anyone has any idea how many layers it has? The glucocorticoids, mineralocorticoids, all these are secreted by the suprarenal gland and with its layers. So there are three different layers. We'll come to that when we take up the suprarenal gland separately in the histology topic. So with these also, we have a lot of, clinical aspects like Cushing syndrome, corticoids. You can relate to Cushing syndrome and many other syndromes. We'll talk about all that in a separate class. And then what is vasopressin? Vasopressin is secreted by the posterior pituitary. Vasopressin, oxytocin and vasopressin is secreted by the posterior pituitary. So this is also humoral factors which influence the increase of blood pressure. And then kidney and fluid balance mechanisms that also increases. So you can see there are some more factors when it comes to decrease of the blood pressure. So it is the baroreceptors. The baroreceptors, you know that there are stretch receptors and baroreceptors that are present on the carotid body, carotid sinus. You have heard of that. When we spoke about the carotid pulse, that is against the C6 vertebrae. Right? We spoke about this. So carotid sinus, carotid body and the baroreceptors, chemoreceptors, all this we spoke about when we spoke about the carotid vessels. And these also help in, you know, maintaining the blood pressure. So reflexes from them, they can decrease the blood pressure. And also prostaglandins, AEI, and kallikrein kinin system and atrium natriuretic factor. All this can decrease the blood pressure. Each one will be discussed separately in the pathology class and physiology classes. All this is, again, a detailed thing that you need to remember, we will discuss. Now, coming to the vasculitis. Now, this is one of the important things that you must know. There is inflammation of the vessels, great vessels. Now, what is that classification? There is classification depending on how big is the vessel. Is it a large vessel? So, large vessel vasculitis, then you have medium vessel vasculitis and small vessel vasculitis. So, here, large vessel vasculitis, you can consider the subclavian carotid. All these are the aorta and its immediate branches. So you must remember the aorta and its immediate branches are the carotids. So carotids, when it comes to carotids, there is external carotid and internal carotid. So all this inflammation, if it happens to ECA and ICA, then it can definitely result in stroke, blindness, because internal carotid again supplies the eye muscles through its branches. Then claudication, stroke, all this is again to do with the external and internal carotid. They are the immediate branches from the aorta. So common carotid and then external and internal carotid. Now, there is medium-sized vessel vasculitis, that is Again, you have wrist drop, foot drop, all this, and then there is mesenteric ischemia. Ischemia is reduction in the flow of the blood to mesentery. So you have mesentery in the small intestine. Small intestinal loops are held by mesenteric vessels. So there is decreased blood flow through abdominal aorta branches. Then that is again, or it could be because of the vasculitis, or it could be some other obstruction. We'll talk about it, whether it is aneurysm or the, you know, vasculitis, that is a different issue. But this can definitely result in ischemia. And then some ulcers, cutaneous ulcers. When the blood supply is not good, then it can result in slow healing. So that is ulcers. Then small vessel vasculitis. Small vessel vasculitis, you have capillaries, arterioles, venules, all this, purpura, glomerulonephritis, any inflammation of the kidney. So what is glomerulonephritis? It is the inflammation of the nephrons. And then there is pulmonary hemorrhage. All this is small vessel vasculitis. So now here, today we are discussing all these things and some more clinical aspects to follow. But before that, it's just quick, you know, information about where you are actually. You are on an academy platform. Okay, so this is something every student must know who is watching this. You are on an academy platform and you are interacting with Dr. Rohini, and I teach anatomy and I have all these classes that is lined up for you. One is special class at 8 a.m. every morning with the gross anatomy important topic. And this topic also follows some MCQs, and then you have a YouTube class at 7 p.m. every evening, and then you have 10 p.m. quiz up. So this YouTube class at 7 p.m. is what you're watching right now. And this is also a topic from your gross anatomy, or it could be histology as well. So gross anatomy clinical is not discussed much. So we are dealing with the clinical aspects of the blood vessels. And then you have 10 p.m. class, which is purely quiz. It is purely quiz program where the questions are asked and all the options that you have, the four options, each one of them is discussed in detail. And then you have special class at 8 a.m. every morning, which I mentioned. And what is coming soon? Coming soon is the plus classes, that is on 19th, 20th. 26th, 27th and 29th of June. This is a Tuesday. So mark your calendars for the important classes. And you also have these limited time offer. You take 36 months. If you think you have, you are in second year and you still have two more years to go, you can prepare well, not just for your PG, but also for your UG with all this wonderful classes. Your basics will become very strong. And 92 is now at 58,500. Like that, you have 24 months for 49,500. 18 months is for 45, and 12 is for 4,500. All this is for first 500 students. And also, you can use this promo code at the footer. You can see this. It is Rohini. And you can avail for the discount, 10% discount. And then you can see that there is 3 months subscription you go for. You get 1 month absolutely free. And this is definitely added to your subscription. You get altogether 4 months for the price of 3 months. And then here, this will be added within 30 days of your subscription. Not just that, you can also boost your medical PG preparation with the 12-month subscription. Not just few months, with many months plus bonus of 2 months, which you can get within 30 days again. And then you can use the code, 10% discount is immediately applied. And all these seasons batches are present, NEET PG seasons batch. It started on June 2nd and you have endless question series and PYQ season, test and analysis, image discussions, and high yield topics revisions, all this is done by the educators. And then you also have evening, if you don't have time in the morning, you also have evening programs from June 2nd itself, that is for 2022 batch. And then you have the similar program, but if you have missed anything, you can definitely go for the recorded session that is available. And then PDF notes are also available for the session, which you can download. So with all these things, you are not missing anything at all. Okay, you have $34,000 curated questions for PG are now available. So you can continue your practice, and then you can also side by side prepare for your NEET PG. You can download the learners app and have access to all the special classes. I was mentioning about my special class at 8 a.m. and this can be accessed with the learners app. You can download from the App Store or the Android Store, and then you can go for NEET PG. You can follow your educators. You can subscribe. To subscribe, my classes, R-O-H-A-Q-U-A is what you are supposed to look for. And you can use this promo code in case your special class you're happy with and you want to go for it. Plus subscription. So this is the promo code R-O-H-I-N-I. And it is my name itself. It is R-O-H-I-N-I is my name, Rohini. And you can use this as the code. And there are so many iconic subscriptions. NEET PG subscription, iconic ones. And all this plus iconic subscriptions you can get for a very reasonable price. Not just that, you can also get it at EMI. Every month you will have to pay just $1,250 if you're going for the 36 months package. A no cost EMI is available with the minimum of 6 month subscription. You go for this, you can go for ₹3,375 per month, and also it will be pocket friendly because you are also getting the 10% discount on this. So with all this, you can use this code R-O-H-I-N-I. It is a promo code that you need to apply to get the subscription. So this is very beneficial because you will not only feel the burden, you will not feel the burden of any, you know, big amount going from your account. So you feel that you are with the course and you have all the interest in the course because the burden is not much and it is just $1,250 every month. And it is for a longer duration, that is 36 months. So it will cover all your 100% classes. So the iconic subscription, you can not just have the access to this Unacademy, but also for the PrepLadder. So PrepLadder and Unacademy, both of them have got very good educators. You can get the video lectures, live classes, quizzes, and everything you have access to. Once you get the subscription for Unacademy, you can have access to PrepLadder as well. So it is a boon because you are getting the benefit of both the platforms. Okay, with all this information, we'll move to our next, you know, set of diseases of the blood vessels. We spoke about some normals and we spoke about simple things like blood pressure measurement and what is vasculitis, which is very simple. Vasculitis can happen with any of the blood vessels, be it a medium or a large, any one of them. So it is inflammation of the vessels. So now here, the other than this, there are other defects as well. So it's not just the blood pressure or the vasculitis that affects the blood vessels, but there are other aspects also to have, you know, complicated things. All right, here we have gyric. What happened? You say hi and then your emoji doesn't suit the hi. Okay, so we have hi gyric and we have Abdul hi. And you have answered it for some medium? Yes. Okay, so you can continue watching. We are going to see some diseases of the blood vessels. So here we have due to age, there could be a lot of changes in the wall of the arteries. So you know that the age is one factor where not just the, you know, blood vessels, the all the organs in the body, they have certain changes in them. So here it is could be because of the muscles or it could be because of the connective tissue. Okay, so now here what it could be. So now thickening of the tunica intima due to migration and proliferation of the smooth muscle cells from the tunica medium. So where is supposed to be the smooth muscles? It is supposed to be in the second layer. From the second layer, if it pushes inside and goes to the tunica intima, so here if this is the lumen and if there is a bump like this that is formed because of the push from the media, then obviously the lumen gets narrowed. This is the lumen and the lumen will get narrowed. So that is one changes that can happen in the tunica intima. So tunica intima is the innermost one. Okay. So this is one age related stuff that can happen. Another one is fibrofatty plaque. So that is called atheroma. Atheroma is what? It's a condition. Atheroma is a condition where there is deposition of not just the connective tissue fibers, that is collagen, but also deposition of fat. That is again a debatable question. There are so many, you know, educators and so many other authors of the books like Hegde, K.S. Hegde, they say that there is nothing like fibrofatty plaque. But this is a debatable question. So you can definitely think it could be because of collagen. Okay. So deposition of the fat and the collagen in tunica intima. So everything is related to tunica intima. Why? Because that is again very close to the lumen. So most of the changes that happens in tunica intima is definitely going to affect the flow of the blood. Next, atheroma. What is that? Atheroma is, so don't, you know, underestimate the names now. Atheroma is what? So now here the formation of the fibrofatty plaques, it leads to atheroma. Now, atheroma is the narrowing of the lumen. So now here it is the blood flow that is affected. Whatever is flowing inside obviously will get affected. Not just that, there is calcification of tunica media. Tunica media is which layer? It is the intima media. It is the second layer. So that is known as arteriosclerosis. Arteriosclerosis. So now what is atherosclerosis? Atherosclerosis is nothing but the thickening or calcification of tunica media plus tunica intima thickening. So which two layers it is involving? The first and second layers it involves. So this is one thing that you must remember. The atherosclerosis involves which two layers of the vessel? That is one and two, intima and media. Is adventitia involved? No. Okay, next. There is damage to endothelium that can happen. So endothelium is intima. So here intima is the innermost one. If there is a thrombus formation, that is clot, blood clot formation, and that can completely obstruct the flow and also lead to the wear and tear of the cells that is lining inside, that is called endothelium. So this can definitely interfere with the flow of the blood, and also it can cause damage to the lining vessel. Okay, so this lining vessel reduces the capacity of the cells to function. Now here there is one more. When it can happen? When do you think such a thing can happen? It can happen, thrombus formation can happen in coronary thrombosis, or it could happen in myocardial infarction. All this, it can happen. So in brain also, many a times this thrombus formation can happen that can lead to stroke and paralysis. So all this can happen. And remember, whenever such a thing happens, it always involves the innermost layer, that is endothelium. So these are some of the changes that can happen with the age. Now this is how it looks. You can see arteriosclerotic changes in a medium-sized artery, which involves one and two layers. Tunica adventitia is untouched. Okay. So that if something happens in tunica adventitia, that is a completely different, you know, aspect. So that we'll discuss that in a different slide. Now we are talking only about the two and the one. You can see the lumen, what has happened in the tunica intima, what has happened. See the internal elastic lamina. It is fragmented. That is the main feature you can see. Instead of being continuous, it is fragmented. And you can also see there is loss of elastic fibers in the tunica medium, because some of the fibers that are present are pushed towards the intima. So smooth muscle fibers are pushed and elastic fibers are pushed to tunica intima. So from two, some of them are pushed. That's why when it gets pushed, these elastic lamina, which is supposed to be continuous like this, becomes fragmented. So that is one thing you are going to notice. So here you can see coronary artery, arteriosclerosis and thrombosis also. So thrombus, you can see if there is a little bit of blood, you can see, but this is a very big clot of blood. And see the lumen, it is very much narrowed. Lumen is very much narrowed. You can see the big clot of blood, and you can see the thickness of the intima. How the intima is also, see the size of the intima here and see the size of the intima here. So this is in the case of arteriosclerosis, where the first and second layer are involved. Has anything happened to the tunica adventitia? No. So what is the structure and function of the blood vessels? You know that there are arteries which carry blood away from the heart. Arterioles are present, and capillaries is where there is exchange of the venous and the arterial blood, and there is veins which carry the blood towards the heart, towards or to the heart, and that is against the gravity. So you can see the basic structures are tunics, and you can see the structures of intima, media and adventitia you can see. But in the adventitia, one important thing that you can notice is vasa vasorum. Okay, so keep this in mind, that is tunica adventitia or externa has vasa vasorum. This is how the structure is. You can see the innermost tunica intima, which is lined by endothelium. Okay, so now in case of veins also, you have intima and you have tunica intima, tunica media and tunica externa. So now here tunica media, this should be tunica media is thinner with little smooth muscles, and externa will be the thickest, which is also called adventitia. So there are so many congenital anomalies that is involved or pathology when it comes to with all these things. You can see that there are so many pathological conditions we can discuss. We'll not 100% move on to the pathology, but we will just give you a glimpse of what are the pathological conditions that you need to know. So we have this congenital anomalies, we have that is defect in the formation of the blood vessels itself. Then arteriosclerosis is what we discussed, 1 and 2. And then this is another one we can, HTN is another one we can discuss, vasculitis or inflammation. And then aneurysms, which can happen to any great vessels like the aortic aneurysm or cerebral aneurysm. Or it could be only with the thoracic aneurysm, thoracic aorta aneurysm. So it could be true aneurysm or false aneurysm. So we'll discuss that. And then also dissections. What is dissections? Anybody? What is dissections? Dissections are which layer is involved in the dissections? In the dissections, the tunica media is involved. So tunica media is involved, and we'll talk about the dissections, that is aortic dissections. So what happens when the tunica media is involved, we'll talk about. Then there is veins and lymphatics. Then there are some tumors that we can discuss. All these are some of the things that is lined up. Okay, so now here, the aneurysm, what is aneurysm? So it is a local, it's just present in one region, particular region. It is not throughout the length of the artery or the vein. It is not throughout the length. It is just dilation at one single point, and that is known as aneurysm. You can see abnormal dilation. It is not normal, it is abnormal. And the wall of the heart that may be congenital or acquired. So it could be present not just in other places. It can also involve the vessels that are supplying the heart. There are two types. One is the true aneurysm. Another one is the false aneurysm. Now here it is bound by arterial wall. Components are involved. And it is attenuated wall of the heart itself. So that is true aneurysm. Now here you can list the atherosclerosis is true aneurysm in case of syphilis and congenital vascular aneurysms and left ventricular aneurysms. All this that can follow myocardial infarction. So anything to do with any of these can be followed by myocardial infarction. So all these are true aneurysm. That is changes in the wall is going to lead to myocardial infarction. And there are some momentary ones. They are called the false or pseudo aneurysm. These pseudo aneurysms are again, it is just a breach in the, and it is there only momentarily, that moment, and it is a breach in the vascular wall. So it could be present as a hematoma, small extravascular hematoma, and it can freely communicate with intravascular space, or it can just be a small obstruction and that can just go away with little bit of changes. And the post myocardial infarction can also have this kind of pseudo aneurysms. So now here I was talking about aneurysm, exactly how does it look like? So they can be classified depending on how it looks in the radiographs. It could look like fusiform like this. It could be like a saccular type. This is usually seen in cerebral ones. This is how it is seen. This is seen in medium-sized ones, medium-sized vessels. Like ulnar, radial, etc. And this one is usually seen in aorta and branches like the abdominal aorta, thoracic aorta, So this is the type you can see in the abdominal and thoracic. And this is cerebral ones, the small nodular type. Okay, so now you can see all this. So fusiform, they having slow spindle-shaped dilation. This is the one. Saccular, they are spherical outpouchings like this. This is saccular. This is the one. And then there is dissecting type that arises when the blood enters the wall of the artery. So now here it could be in the medium-sized vessels. There are some cylindrical ones also, which again go continuous with the dilation of the vessel. So it is very difficult to identify. Which one is very difficult if someone asks you? It is the cylindrical type, because it looks exactly like a dilated vessel through and through. So you can't make out the aneurysm exactly at what point there is aneurysm. Next, you have serpentine or varicose type. It is dilation of the entire vessel. So it could be like a varicose vein. And there is racemose, and that is again intercommunicating with other small vessels like arteries and veins with all its branches as well. There is berry aneurysm, which is again a very important one. And this is what usually seen in circle of Willis. So this is the important one to remember. In circle of Willis, what is the name of the aneurysm? They are the small dilations that is present both in case of internal carotid artery branches. It affects most of the internal carotid artery branches, like anterior communicating branch, or it could be ophthalmic branch. In that case, it can change a lot of, changes can happen with the eyes. So you can go for the complications. What will happen in case this is not treated and addressed? Thrombosis, embolism, and rupture of the vessels can happen. So you can see this saccular type, fusiform type, and this is how it ruptures. Okay, so now you can see it is based on the pathologic mechanism. We can simply call it as, is it because of the syphilis, secondary to syphilis, or is it because of dissecting type of aneurysm, or is it because of the infection from the pathogens? It could be the fungus. Atherosclerotic, it could be the plaque, thrombus. This is how it looks, aneurysm. Aneurysm is a general term. It is just a dilation. Okay, it can be classified depending on what is causing the dilation. Okay, so that is what we are discussing now. So here you have descending aorta, thoracic aorta aneurysm looks like this. This is fusiform. And this is the diaphragm where it enters the abdomen. So here, when such a thing happens, the blood does, the blood does not flow into the aorta easily. So because there is this dilation in the and narrowing of the lumen. And sometimes I told you there are so many pathogenesis. There are so many aneurysms. And this can be associated with some of the connective tissue disorders as well. It is not just because of the quality of the vascular wall, but it is also defect in the connective tissue synthesis itself. So there are two disorders which we are going to discuss today. And in part 3, we will discuss more of them, like varicose veins and other defects. We are going to discuss a lot of them that is listed. That is going to be after 1 or 2 days. And today we are going to discuss two things, that is Marfan syndrome and Ehlers-Danlos syndrome. What happens here exactly? What is affected? We will discuss. Okay, so now here you can see that in Marfan syndrome, what happens? We have to... Let's see if there is anyone who has the questions. Okay. So in Marfan syndrome, what happens is the intrinsic quality of the vascular wall, that is connective tissue, is poor. The connective tissue is defective. So when the connective tissue is defective, you can say that this, especially the Marfan syndrome, is defective synthesis on protein fibrillin. So protein fibrillin is defective, and you must remember various list of things that goes with it. Let's see whether you can see. See, in this picture you can see. So you remember the protein fibrillin, and then you remember the list of things that I am going to write here. So you have all these symptoms in the Marfan syndrome. See here, the chest, look at the chest. What has happened to the sternum? It could be, you know, either it is abnormally, you know, inverted or pigeon chest, you can say, or it could be curved abnormally. And this particular, you know, height, you can identify in Marfan syndrome with long extremities. The extremities are long. That is one thing. The person will have eye problems, eye defects, because I told you that it affects the blood vessels. That's why. It can affect the internal carotid artery and its branches. Okay, we are talking about aneurysm. And then you have the, it can affect the heart and it can affect lung. So this is the heart, lung, and abnormal chest. And the short torso you can see. And the limbs are long with the fingers and other, you know, parts of the palm are very long compared to normal person. And here you can also see that the high arched neck, the neck is high arched. And the person may have flat foot. This is flat foot. And the joints are extremely flexible because of the connective tissue disorder. So now here the person may also have heart murmurs. Again, that has got something to do with the blood vessel defect. And you can also see that he may also have some curved spine defect. Not just eye problem, he may also have problem with his teeth. Because wherever the connective tissue is there, is defective. So either it is intended or protruding sternum, you can see, and dislocated lenses of the eye. So the person may have nearsightedness. You can see the joints are very flexible, and you can also see lot of other changes compared to a normal person. So this is an inherited disorder that you should remember. It is an inherited disorder of the protein fibrillin, which is supposed to, when this fibrillin is the one which is supposed to, you know, activate the connective tissue production. So when connective tissue production is interrupted, that is because of the mutation. So which mutation? There is mutation in some of the genes which is called FBN1. Okay, so this is the gene which, this is fibrillin 1. So which is very important for the production of connective tissue. So when there is a mutation in this particular gene, then it can result in all these changes. This is a very, very important slide, I can say, which you must remember. And many of the times the picture based, you know, things are more interesting, and you can take up or you can remember. See, now this picture, particular picture with all these things, if you remember. See now here, high arched neck, you can see narrow face. It just goes with the all the explanations. You can see extremely tall stature, build is very thin, and then long face, long arms, everything you can see. The teeth is crowded. Everything you can make out. And this picture itself is self-explanatory. Next one, you can see in this picture, this is a person who has indented or protruding sternum. So in case this comes as for an exam in a picture-based question, immediately you should be identifying this as Marfan syndrome. And this is the defect of joints, blood vessels, bones, and especially heart related. These are the major ones. Other than that, you have eye related ones, you have teeth related ones, you have long neck, and then you also have long face, then you have long arms, and then all others, short torso, all this. Okay, next one. There is one more condition where the atherosclerosis and then aneurysms are very common. Let's see what is that. See, this is the picture of a person who has a disease which is called the Ehlers-Danlos syndrome. Ehlers-Danlos syndrome. So this is again type 3 collagen synthesis defect. So there are type 1, type 2, and type 3. So now here, type 3 is what is important for blood vessels. So this one is the defect in the type 3 collagen synthesis, and you can identify certain conditions where the skin is so elastic that it just hangs from the surface of the body. So that is one important thing, and they have lot of skin related issues that is never ending. So this is Ehlers-Danlos syndrome, and they have extremely flexible joints. Okay, so is there any question so far? I don't see any questions. Okay, now here, this is also inherited. I was talking about Marfan syndrome. This is inherited. It's not acquired. This is also inherited. So both are inherited type of connective tissue disorders. Now in this, what happens? Now mainly the joints, the skin, and the blood vessels. Here the bones are not affected. Eyes, teeth, nothing is affected. It's mainly the skin that shows so much of difference. It just, lacks connective tissue. It lacks connective tissue. That's what happens in the Ehlers-Danlos syndrome. So now here, since the connective tissue is lacking, the skin loses its elasticity. And also anything that happens on the skin, like ulcers it could be, or any other conditions, purpura, ulcers, all these are very slow healing. So now here we can discuss more on this with the picture. You can see in this picture, you can see the skin is elastic here. So now here there is mutation in not just one gene. So that was mutation in a single gene, that is fibrillin. But that was FBN1, that is in Marfan syndrome, right? And here in Ehlers, there is mutation in at least 20 genes. At least 20 genes undergo mutation to cause a condition where the skin is just sagging like this, and there are skin conditions like this. Okay, joints are flexible. See the joints. All these joints are flexible and they are bent. Okay, so that is one thing. And here the gene that is responsible for most of the connective tissue is COL1A1 and 5A1. This is collagen 1A1, 5A1. These are the ones which are defective. What is this condition? Ehlers. Okay, so now here the affected parts are the joints. Joints become very painful all the time. They hurt and pain, and there is also all the time headaches. And the skin is very, very, very stretchy. And you can say that it is also fragile. So what happens here is the blood vessels, they dilate. And they result in decreased blood pressure. They decrease the blood. They always have decreased blood pressure because the dilation of the blood vessels. Why they do? They are not competent because of the connective tissue that is supposed to hold, and the patency of the wall is because of the connective tissue. If the connective tissue is not cooperating, then they lose their elasticity and the lumen remains very dilated or big. So you can't make out. You can make out that very easily in the radiographs, angiograms. So you can make out. So that is going to reduce the blood pressure. So now here, not just that, they are joints are very flexible, and see how the finger is bent like this. Look at the finger, how it is bent. And see all these fingers, how they are bent. And there is skin condition here. So this is the Ehlers syndrome. So this should give you an idea about the various things. So now here, the balance of collagen degradation and synthesis is very, very important in case of aneurysms. So how much is degraded and how much is produced? So vascular wall will get weakened if there is too much of loss. Loss is more than production. If there is too much loss and there is less production, then that can result in there is too much loss and less production is what causes all these changes in the wall of the vessels. Now, this is where we are going to stop, and we are going to stop it here. This is the part two. We have another part three that is coming up, where you can discuss more clinical conditions. Don't forget the gene name, mutated gene name. And you please don't forget the symptoms associated with the Marfan's and the Ehlers syndrome. So remember all this. With all this, I'm going to stop here. And me, Dr. Rohini, signing off for this 7 p.m. class. And this topic was about the blood vessel changes, with which some are age related, some are connective tissue related, and some are the tunics related. So with all this, today we are going to stop with the part two. We'll start part two in 1 or 2 days. Thanks for watching. Kindly follow and like, please. Can you please hit a like, whoever is watching this video? Thank you.